Good afternoon, everybody. We are going to go ahead and get started, beginning with just a few opening remarks by President McInnis, and then we will get started. So I'll ask everyone to please take your seats and maybe silence your phones, and we're good to go.
Well, good morning, good afternoon, everyone. It's been a long week. So we're to afternoon. Great to see so many of you here. And I'd like to thank you all for attending, including Maheen Khan and Michael Sheed, who are representing United States Senator Kirsten Gillibrand. And really glad to have everybody here for what is the last in what has been a series of events this week for the inauguration, but this one focused on tackling inequality in higher education, past and present. This week of inauguration has been especially moving after a year and a half of pandemic living and working, and there have been moments of joy, of community, and of collective excitement about our future. On many occasions, I've talked about the transformative power of education, and I've certainly had many opportunities to reflect on this week, especially its ability to unlock potential and spur creativity. But on the same note, as president of Stony Brook University, it is my responsibility to continue the conversations around the complex history of American higher education. For while it is widely acknowledged that higher education has long been the engine driving America's economic prosperity, and while for many a college education has been the doorway to the American dream, it is important that we acknowledge that for far too long it has not been accessible to all. And today, we know that there are still significant barriers to equitable access. Stony Brook was created to provide access to an excellent education to a growing and increasingly diverse population in New York. That was the premise upon which Stony Brook was founded, and it's a mission that I am dedicated to uphold as president, but we know there is still much work to do. I'm very excited for today's conversation that is going to help us understand the legacies of the past and how it is that we are where we are today, but also conversations about how we can move things forward in the future. I'm going to introduce the organizer for the symposium, and I am so deeply grateful to our own Jennifer Anderson, Associate Professor of History, whose interdisciplinary scholarship examines the connections between people, natural environments, and material culture. Her current project, the development of which received a Scholar and Society Fellowship from the American Council of Learned Societies and the Mellon Foundation, focuses on the history of segregation, access, and economic inequality right here on Long Island. And she will introduce today's speakers. Jenny.
Thank you, and I'm so delighted that everyone is here. When we first had the glimmer of an idea to have this event, we didn't actually know whether we would be in person or online or how the event would happen. So I'm really grateful to be here today in three dimensions. And just quickly to see who is in the house, first of all, I want to welcome all of our special guests visitors who are here today. And I'd like to know, are there any students in the house from Stony Brook University? Give a yell out. Do I have any faculty in the house? Okay, you sound feeble, faculty. Do I have any staff here, members in the house? Hardworking staff. And do we have GSEU in the house, the Graduate Student Union? Welcome. Thank you, everybody, to be here. So when I was initially asked by the president and the inaugural committee to put together a symposium, really in honor of Maurie's deep commitment to history and the work that she's done, and reflecting on how that informs her leadership, I was asked to basically said, put together a symposium around a topic that you're passionate about. And thinking about my own work and how it intersected with our president's scholarship, the idea of thinking about inequality and the way that it has manifested in so many different ways over time. In many ways, we see patterns of racialized segregation and economic inequalities that were laid down, reinforced, and perpetuated across time. As the president said, I see this in my own scholarship here on Long Island, and I certainly see it as something that continues to be important to be thinking about and trying to figure out how this came to be in order to think about how we can begin to tackle it. So I don't know if any of you saw the president's lecture earlier this week where she talked about her scholarship on Thomas Jefferson's plans to build the University of Virginia. And she described in fascinating detail how Jefferson designed a landscape in which the presence of the enslaved workers was obscured from the landscape in very concrete physical ways, that they became the backdrop, even though their labor was critical to the university operations. And yet they were excluded from any possibility of participating in or contributing to the intellectual life of that academic community. Today, of course, the landscape of academia is very different, and yet many inequities persist at many levels of academia, some more visible than others, and I would say with the recent COVID epidemic, many have been laid bare in ways that we perhaps didn't really recognize before, especially people in the caregiving professions that we all rely on so much. So thinking about this, one of the angles that I'm particularly concerned about is issues of faculty diversity. Here at Stony Brook, we would really like to see our faculty reflect the diversity of our undergraduate body. And I was recently on a job search where I was trying to get people to apply for a job at Stony Brook, a really great job. And we could not get it. The diversity of applicants that we wanted, even though we did a lot of outreach all over the country and overseas to bring in a diverse applicant pool. And it occurred to me then, and it's continued to trouble me, that the challenge is that we don't have a diverse enough pool of people coming into our graduate programs and who are coming into undergraduate, into college, and then making the step into graduate school. So I've really been concerned and interested in thinking about what the barriers are, what are the obstacles, and are there ways that we can begin to challenge those, to rethink what is the landscape we want to see in academia here at Stony Brook and across the country, and to think together about how we set our priorities and figuring out next steps to realize our best hopes. So that's really what my motivation was. It's a long story. So I'm going to now introduce our panelists, and we'll have first two presentations by our historians, and then we're going to convene with the rest of the panelists to talk in a more conversational panel model about some of the themes that we have been exploring. So first of all, Professor Edward Ayers is joining us. He is the Professor of Humanities and President Emeritus at the University of Richmond. Written and edited 12 books, including In the Presence of My Enemies, Civil War in the Heart of America, favorite of mine, but more importantly, the winner of the Bancroft and the Beveridge Prizes, as well as many other important books, including The Promise of the New South, which was a finalist for the National Book Award and the Pulitzer Prize. He's also served as the president of the OAH, the Organization of American Historians, and been named National Professor of the Year. In 2013, he received the National Humanities Medal from President Obama, who hailed Professor Ayers' commitment to making our history as widely available and accessible as possible. So welcome, Dr. Ayers. Then our next speaker is VanJessica Gladney, who is a doctoral student from the University of Pennsylvania, who's worked with the Penn and Slavery Project that she'll be talking about today since its inception.
As a graduate student, she researched the 18th century connections between slavery and the University of Penn's original and current campuses. And since graduating in 2018, she has served as a provost public history fellow, presenting information about that project to members of the greater Philadelphia community. Welcome, VanJessica. Then joining us from joining us on Zoom, we have another guest who is here in the stead of Gia Bryant, who was initially planning to attend and was not able to make it. So Casey Nguyen was able to step in on short notice, and we're really grateful for her to be here. So she'll be joining us actually on the screen. Casey is a data and policy analyst with the Education Trust of New York. Her responsibilities include collecting and analyzing data to support the mission of improving educational experiences and outcomes for post-secondary students. As the daughter of Vietnamese immigrants, she was encouraged to value education as a driver of opportunity. And after receiving her BA in Community Development and Asian American Studies from the University of California at Davis, she pursued her master's in education policy here in New York at Teachers College. Prior to joining the Education Trust, she served as development coordinator for the Opportunity Network, which is dedicated also to improving access, academic achievement, and career readiness for students from underrepresented communities. And last but not least, we have our own Dawn Medley here, who's joined Stony Brook. When did you join Stony Brook?
In July.
So she's coming here with really fresh eyes. And she is the Vice Provost for Enrollment Management and Retention. She leads all of our international and domestic enrollment efforts at the undergraduate and graduate levels. Prior to joining Stony Brook, she was Associate Vice President of Enrollment at Wayne State University in Michigan. And prior to that was the Vice President at St. Andrews University. She has a BS in English Education from the University of Missouri, a Master's in Administration from the Southeast Missouri State University, and an EDS from Lindenwood. You're way overeducated. From Lindenwood University. An impressive resume. So she is an expert in financial aid, access, and innovative support systems for students, and I think we will be really interested to hear your perspective as a newcomer to Stony Brook. Okay, Professor Ayers.
Thanks very much. It's great to see everybody. Appreciate you having me here. And I knew these other topics that were being discussed, I'm interested in every single one of them. I'll touch on them a little bit. But I thought that I'd pull the camera back and take a broad view. And I said, we have another panelist right there, right in front of me, so it's good to see you, Casey. So, now, as we know, America has a long and complicated relationship with its colleges and universities. On one hand, the love is obvious in the number of alumni who give back to their schools, in the millions of bumper and window stickers proclaiming the driver's attendance, or at least visit to a particular institution, the vast gatherings at football games, the number of caps, shirts, shorts, sweatshirts, jackets, flags, mailbox covers, toilet seats, golf bags, and even caskets emblazoned with school logos and colors. And I saw the sign for the Seawolves. I just want to be honest with you right now. The Richmond Spiders are playing you tomorrow. But we're just going to set all that. I know how inflamed all of you are thinking about that game coming up tomorrow, but we'll just set that aside for now. Now, no other country in the world has such things. In other places, universities are more like public utilities than passionate tribes that they are in the U.S. Places that are pleasant enough and necessary for professional advancement, but hardly the signifiers of identity, class, achievement, vicarious athletic prowess, and human worth that they embody in the U.S. Schools are hard to get into elsewhere in the world, but no other country has created the complex machinery of selection that the United States has. Now, it could be, and often is, argued that universities are America's greatest collective accomplishment. They are the source of much of our country's comparative economic and military advantage, and they serve as a great escalator of social mobility, as close as we come to having a civic faith in this country. Taken as a whole, our nation's system of higher education, from community colleges up to the most selective institutions, may be the most democratic space in America. Now, those of us in higher education know this and still believe in institutionalized idealism. We believe that if we build the right structures with the right principles, we can change individual lives, which in turn make the places those people live and work better. We combine some of the aspirations of religion and human resource management, of families and sports franchises, of small towns and major corporations. That's why there is so much interest in what colleges and universities do. Many people have big stakes in our actions, seeing us accurately as reflections and of the problems and possibilities of society at large. Now, questions about affordability are questions about social mobility in America. Questions about diversity are questions about fairness in this nation. Questions about our use of technology are questions about the future of human interaction everywhere. But despite all this love of specific institutions, and despite our undeniable success in building world-class colleges and universities, many Americans are suspicious of, disdainful of, neglectful of, and even antagonistic to its colleges and universities and the things that go on there. It's a paradox. Well over 90% of people say they are glad they went to the college they went to and go there again. But if you ask general questions, what do you think is the direction of higher education? People have concerns about somebody else's colleges. Now, some people have made careers criticizing higher education from across the political spectrum. From one perspective, we hear that colleges and universities are overrun with radicals. From another, we hear that colleges and universities are overrun with corporate ideals and managerial ideals. From one side, we hear that college costs too much because the federal government subsidizes students who shouldn't be there. From the other, we hear that college costs too much because state and federal governments have starved them. From one side, we hear that colleges need to rely more on online instruction and efficiencies that come from replacing expensive tenure-track faculty with adjuncts. From the other, we hear that online education and contingent faculty are new ways to induce values of business to take over higher education. And within higher education, too, we divide among ourselves in unhelpful ways. I had written this before I walked into this building. I just take this as some kind of cosmic connection. It sometimes seems to me that higher education is like an M.C. Escher drawing, I wrote, in which perspectives are distorted so that everyone can look down on everyone else. The contempt and competition among the schools within a university is legendary. Departments and divisions look down on one another for being too theory-laden or not theoretical enough, too empirical or not sufficiently empirical, too hip or too traditional. We waste many possibilities with such parochialism. The contempt widely directed toward administrators is also corrosive. I should also say, in the spirit of forthcomingness, I was dean of the College and Graduate School of Arts and Sciences at Virginia before I became president at Richmond. Tired jokes of faculty about their colleagues going over to the dark side of administration are not merely cliched, but misguided and self-defeating, trivializing and diminishing dedication to the shared purposes of the institution. Believe in shared governance, you should want your faculty to rise to become leaders of the institution. The lifeblood of education, I know from having taught 20 years before I became an administrator, travels through capillaries, through small vessels that reach into small classrooms and quiet conversations and silent reading. But when I became dean, I saw that those capillaries flow only because of the arteries and veins of admissions and finance, student affairs, and advancement. People far removed from the classroom make it possible for other people to be teachers and students. They minister to students when professors are not there in the middle of the night. They call the parents when a terrible accident strikes. They make sure the classrooms and offices work. They balance the budgets and protect the benefits of everyone. Distrust and disdain among institutions and sectors are also common and wasteful. The hierarchies between public and private, large and small, national and regional, serve no one well, inflating arrogance at some and instilling resentment in others. We all know how ridiculous the U.S. News rankings are, but we also know pretty much exactly where we stand within them. The differences among schools tend not to be what we often assume. The distinctions between public and so-called private, which are in fact not private, they're just 501c3 nonprofits, are exaggerated. It turns out that small schools that are seldom wealthy welcome students who might have stumbled a bit in high school and help them learn how to succeed. with tiny endowments, no margin for error, no funding at all from the state. These schools change lives decade after decade. Historically black colleges and universities, generation after generation, make an outsized impact. At large publics, in turn, many of the strengths of small colleges find their own versions in independent research and study abroad. Talent and passion are far more broadly distributed among faculty and students across our country than these phony distinctions reveal. Community colleges and open access regional schools do some of the most important work in our country, and yet are marginalized financially and in other ways. People in those institutions are proud to teach students from over 100 different countries, students proficient in English at various levels, with only a limited time to devote to a course because they're working to raise a family. Faculty at those schools do not buy into the notion, common inside and outside the academy, that the more thoroughly pre-selected the students are, the smarter the professor is. In fact, they believe the contrary. Now, these commonplace criticisms of higher education from inside and outside undermine the possibilities of higher education. Because mothers and fathers read about scary levels of debt among some students, they fail to explore the hundreds of millions of dollars of financial aid available to them. Because their sons and daughters read exaggerated articles about getting into a few colleges with a perfect fit, they miss opportunities in their own backyards. Because students are told that the only skills that matter are the skills that employers want right this minute, they deprive themselves of the opportunity to acquire tools for a lifetime. To see our situation and our possibilities more clearly, we need to recognize at least two parallel kinds of truth. One truth reminds us that the range, depth, and diversity of Americans achieving higher education has increased exponentially over the last 50 years. Between 1970 and 1910, the total number of students increased from 8.5 million to 20.6 million. And the numbers and rates are still increasing. The number of female students increased from 3.5 million in those years to 11.7 million. The percentage of students of color doubled. Since 2000, the number of low-income students enrolled in college has increased 14%, the number of female students by 29%, the number of black students by 73%, and the number of Latinx students by 126%. Today, three-fourths of high school graduates seek some form of higher education. The wage gap between college-educated and non-college educated people is higher now than it's ever been. Four-year net tuition has been virtually flat since 1990 for all kinds of schools. 85% of students at nonprofit undergraduate schools receive financial aid. I can tell you, people in the world don't know these things. I can tell you that people have locked into perceptions of the situation, and all I would have to think about, let's think about the importance of gender equality, or at least equity, or at least steps toward that last half century, finally translating into greater representation among faculty and university leaders and even presidents. This is a major social transformation of profound and positive consequence. We shouldn't take it for granted, but we must build on it in intentional ways. It's a model for other forms of inclusion and expansion. Far from being hidebound and resistant to innovation, ivory tower nonsense, higher education is and has been one of the most dynamic economic and social components of American society since World War II. Our universities have developed the most transformative industries of our time and have been on the forefront of every major social change, progressive and otherwise. They've been agents of integration, inclusion, and internationalization, advancing the society far beyond their own gates. Now, understanding this context of expanded opportunity and diversity helps us understand other things as well. It is not surprising that higher education costs more when it finally begins to serve a vast, diverse, and often poorer student body, when it educates more people from more backgrounds in more ways. Higher education is hard, intellectually and socially, and it's not surprising that those who are the first in their family to go to college, or who speak English as a second language, or have other work responsibilities, require more support. Student welfare, engagement, and protection have become institutional responsibilities, and those responsibilities bring a cost as well as enormous benefits to people within and beyond our colleges and universities. And yet, I see no taking that into account in all the people who complain about the rising cost of education. Students of all backgrounds benefit from freshman seminars and capstone projects and international studies and undergraduate research. These strategies require close personal interaction. The research has proven these are the high impact practices that make an education excellent. But they require this interaction. They cannot be mass produced. They cannot be outsourced. They actually make the institution work more intensively rather than extensively. They point toward more faculty, not fewer. They point toward face-to-face involvement in all aspects of a student's life, not at a distance. The fact is that higher education costs more because it's doing more, providing more to the society. So American higher education, in other words, has never educated more people. It has never educated a broader array of people. It has never offered an education that embraces so many fields of learning. It has never offered degrees more valuable and more coveted, and it has never been more respected and appreciated by the people who actually benefit from it. The world admires and copies every aspect of America's diverse system of higher education, from our liberal arts colleges to our research universities. So that's one kind of truth. The truth of hard-won and far-reaching success, which for some reason we tend to skate by. But there is another truth, also real and powerful. Student debt and low levels of completion. Those two problems go together. For the students who do not finish are those who cannot repay the debt they acquire. While most who graduate do not build up large amounts of debt and default rates are low, students who give up after a year or two are not equipped to get a job that allows them to repay the debt. Students who stumble in one of the introductory gateway courses in math, science, history, or English, they get a D at the community college, their first semester out of high school, often fail to proceed at alarming percentages. As a historian, it seems to us that anybody could do the history of the United States, and yet people get D's and F's in it. And they are held back just as people are who do don't do well in courses that I could not do well either. Many students do not make the move from 2 to 4 year schools, and 40% of students start at 2 year schools. We can't afford for people to give up early before they actually have a chance. Many students give up on college because they are working or taking care of family members. For these reasons and more, far too many who start college do not finish college even in 6 years. So juxtaposing those two truths, we see that we've made progress with equity and access. Now we need to focus on equity and success as well. Dr. McInnis made impressive progress at her time in Texas, and I know it's determined that she's going to make progress at Stony Brook as well. Those of us in higher education, whatever our roles, can help students succeed. Encouragement comes in the classroom, but it also comes in the residence hall, and in the cafeteria, and in the library, and on the playing field, and in clubs, and in research work, and in campus jobs. All of those places offer the opportunity for a kind word, a genuine question, a moment of respect that can make people feel that they belong at these institutions, that they've worked so hard to get into, but which sometimes, oftentimes, do not seem as welcoming as the brochures had suggested. And more technical intervention helps too, from enrollment management, I also had this written before I knew we were speaking, to curriculum design, to financial aid. Chairs, deans, and provosts can help smooth the path of success. Coordination and planning can pay huge dividends. That's the other thing I learned when I became dean and president. Boy, the intentionality that you can bring to actually coordinating all these different activities pay enormous dividends. And I will say that we tripled our students of color at Richmond, and people say, how in the world did you do this? And I said, shoe leather and econometric modeling. Enrollment management. You have to identify that as the purpose, but unless you know how to do it, all the goodwill in the world isn't going to deliver. And unless you have all those administrators working to figure out how to get all these pieces of the machine working together, all the goodwill in the world is not going to improve your numbers. Presidents can make these things a priority and make things happen. The paradoxes of inequality are especially evident, puzzling, and counterintuitive in the part of higher education I know best and care about the most, the humanities. The more exclusive and expensive the college or university, by and large, the more established the relative position of the humanities. I love it when people say, huh, and I can hear, oh, that's surprising, or, you agree with me? Feel free at any time, that's all good. Faculty and administrative leaders in those universities are often chosen from the ranks of the humanities, as you've shown the wisdom to have done here as well. The most favored students in this country understand the value of the humanities because they see their value demonstrated with each graduating class. As people go off to every kind of career or professional school that turn out to show little regard for major. This is one of the discoveries I made when I was dean of arts and sciences, and I was hanging out with the dean of the graduate business school and medical school and the law school, and they said, you know, we're not looking for political science majors in law school, and we're not looking for biochemistry majors in the medical school. Give me a religious studies major who's taken the six classes that you need to get in medical school. We'd much rather have them. And give me a biochemistry major in law school. We'd much rather. But we're glad to have humanities majors doing any of these things. But if you're not at an elite school where you have the connections on Wall Street and the connections into the research institutes and so forth, it can be scary to think about getting a degree in history. People coming from those elite schools know that a humanities degree over the course of a lifetime pays at least as well as a business degree and offers many wide array of broader opportunities. So coming out with a classics degree from Princeton allows you to walk onto into a Wall Street firm and make a case about why you can do that. But there's only a limited number of schools that they will allow that for. So the humanities, what I find is that too many students at non-elite schools do not feel they can risk a humanities degree. It should not be surprising that black students, finally given a chance at college, major in business far more often than in other disciplines. For first generation, immigrant, or working class students, pre-vocational or vocational majors make more immediate sense, even though such majors often limit their long-term flexibility and opportunity, even their ability to get into the graduate schools that they most want. A 3-1 in chemistry isn't going to get you in medical school. A 3-9 in philosophy, even if you aced organic, might. I find that people just don't understand that you're not deciding right out of high school what you're going to be. An unappreciated crisis of the humanities lives right here. The humanities are not reaching those who might find them most useful, who would find the greatest difference in their lives as a result of seeing with the magnification and broadening the humanities offer. The humanities and the faculty who teach them struggle at schools where students and the institution itself do not have confidence in the value of the humanities. If these trends continue, the humanities may become the exclusive property of those with especially large amounts of personal, cultural, or institutional capital, an apparent luxury good that actually turns out to be a remarkably valuable good. The current crisis is exactly the wrong time for us to give up on the humanities or the uniquely American faith in a broad education that prepares for the unintended and unexpected. The crisis does not lie, again, as in the op-eds say, in scholarly fashions or canon wars or atrophied scholarship. Rather, the crisis lies in opportunities unfulfilled, in groups the humanities are not reaching. Different kinds of crisis intersect in our least favored schools. Students who struggle to finish high school or attend community colleges or open access publics or depleted private or parochial colleges need the perspective the humanities have to offer. but it is the teachers in those very schools who are most beleaguered, most overworked, most likely to be adjuncts teaching several jobs at once. Investing in the humanities in those schools would pay large dividends, making it possible for our dedicated young PhDs to make a decent living by teaching there. The humanities, wherever they live, cannot afford to be cautious or elitist. They must put themselves forward in a world that needs what the humanities have to offer. I'm deeply engaged right now in leading conversations in my own institutions about the legacies of slavery and segregation in which we are ensnared. I coordinated 8 hours of intense conversation this last week and have 16 hours of intense conversation coming up this coming week. These are the issues that our students, frankly, rather suddenly care about and are fundamentally issues of the humanities that must be addressed. So putting these pieces together, I came to a surprising conclusion for me. So I'm a professor, I was a dean, I'm a president, and then what? You've seen all this. What matters ultimately? And I came to the strange conclusion that our disciplines might be our best way forward. Now that, to use my favorite academic word, is counterintuitive, what other people call stupid or wrong, but counterintuitive. Why? Now we've long seen science do such work. Think about science fairs and the outreach that science faculty make back in to elementary schools. But we've had these divisions in lots of other divisions, disciplines, including my own, of history, probably the most commonly taught subject in our schools, but almost no connective materials between the high school and the college. We actually, in some ways, amplify divisions between secondary and post-secondary education, between community colleges and four-year schools, between public-facing work in our classrooms. Our professional organizations try to bridge those differences, but our annual meetings still disproportionately focus on relatively arcane research contributions rather than the mission that faculty and students at many kinds of schools share. So I've tried to distribute professional expertise and inspiration through digital networks and a new project called New American History, trying to make free, open educational resources to schools of every age. Right now in Virginia, we have a gubernatorial election coming up. And what's the hottest issue? What are we teaching in our schools? How do we talk about race? And so I helped work on the standards of learning for Virginia and trying to advance all this. But the school board meetings and the parent meetings are the very thing this gubernatorial election is about, which in many ways is going to help determine what the congressional elections across the country are about next year and the presidential election. So this idea that history is somehow tangential is an illusion. It is the thing that is in many ways the marrow of our communities. I decided that it's important to show a seventh grader that we all live in history all the time as it is to conduct a graduate seminar. Those of us who teach must reach across these phony divisions, these hollow hierarchies. If we want more students coming to college, we need to reach them before it's time to start filling out the FAFSA form. We need to show them why they would want to come to college, the kinds of things that can happen there, why it matters, why it's okay for them to be interested in what they're interested in, that they can make a living with that. If their passion is going to drive it. We cannot afford to have a person's life chances determined by the options they think that lie before them when they're 17 years old. We cannot rely on textbook publishers, so-called content providers, who sell our shared legacy back to us. We must rely on our shared devotion to knowledge and telling the truth. We cannot wait before we act on governments to restore funding and hope for mega gifts or expect some foundation to solve our problems. We need to work in what we know, what we're devoting our own lives to, what we care about. We need to build these communities even as we continue to politic, as we continue to pressure the governments, as we continue to make the case for this. But we cannot afford to wait, because what do we have? We have our knowledge, our commitment, and our determination to act democratically, and we can do that right now. Thanks very much, everyone.
Hello. I'm just gonna.
Okay. Hi, I'm VanJessica Gladney. I'm a third year graduate student at the University of Pennsylvania, and I can't wait to have a conversation with you. A lot of the things that you were saying really resonated with me. I came to Penn as an undergrad. I started in engineering because, as a student of color, my parents said, you need to go to school to get a job. And I was not happy doing engineering because I'm very bad at math. So then I told them, I'm going to get an English degree. And they said, what happened to all those computer science things? And I said, I'll figure out how to use it somehow. And as I eventually became a historian, I figured out a way to do so. So I'm going to tell you a little bit about how I integrated those and tried to push back against my university and help them think about things in a different way. Okay, so in 2006, the Brown University came out and, you know, acknowledged the connections it had with slavery. And that same year, my university said that they were confident that we were very different, that we were on the right side of the issue because we had no connections to the institution of slavery. We said the same thing again in 2016, when we said we had no direct university involvement with slavery or the slave trade. In 2017, a group of undergraduates, myself included, set out to challenge that claim, and we found that that was incorrect. In the 18th century, several of our faculty and trustees owned enslaved people and were compensated for labor that they themselves did not perform. Those trustees then turned around and traveled to South Carolina and Jamaica to seek donations from prominent slave owners in those two areas. And sometimes when we talk about slavery in U.S. history, we like to make a differentiation between domestic slavery and plantation slavery. Well, in South Carolina and Jamaica, there's a lot more plantations than there are in Pennsylvania. So we left Pennsylvania to go get money from them. In the medical school, there were scientists who used the bodies of enslaved people or just people of color in general to certify race science and new scientific racism to establish an intellectual hierarchy that placed white people at the top and black people at the bottom, which has led to so many problems, not only in the terms of medical misinformation, but one of the reasons that I am the only, or one of the only people of color in this room, because there were centuries of being told that I did not belong in spaces like these because I could not get to them. Thank you for the snaps, I appreciate that. we kept conducting more research and digging through the archives, and I started looking around at my campus and realized I didn't really know that much about my school. When I started looking, I saw, oh wait, that guy that I looked at in the archives who was really racist, oh my God, he has a building named after him. Oh my God, he has a statue. And this is our freshman dorms, and the dorms that are highlighted are dorms that are named after slave owners. I did not live in one of the highlighted ones, but I did live in this quad. And if you look at this red statue right here, or this red dot, that's a statue, and we'll get back to that. But yeah, I started looking around, and I realized I did not know that much about my campus. And I saw the story they were telling about themselves. So the Penn Slavery Project and I decided the best way to tell the story correctly is to, you know, use the stage they set up for us. So we developed the Penn Slavery Project Augmented Reality Tour. You can take a tour around campus with your phone. You don't have to go in order, you know, but there are six stops that all feature student research. When you select one of the stops, you see information that students have researched and AR exhibits that kind of reveal the hidden history on Penn's campus. I started with, you know, the different things we found. Well, one of the things we found was ownership. We have a big statue of Benjamin Franklin. Don't know if you know, but he was a slave owner, so that's a thing. And we decided to put a picture. Okay, sorry. So there's this enslaved man named Caesar. And Caesar was owned by Ebenezer Kennersley. Kennersley was one of our first oratory professors, and he was a dorm master. And so Caesar would work for Ebenezer Kennersley, and the trustees paid Kennersley for Caesar's labor. So we created this, we reimagined this portrait where you have Caesar and, let me see if it'll start. Okay, so you've got Caesar and Kennersley and Mrs. Kennersley, and we have this superimposed, you put up your phone and it appears under Benjamin Franklin's statue because, you know, all the things that he has done in our university were because of slavery, and then, or were based on the financial slavery, yeah. And then, sorry, we have made it so that you're centering, we're like centering the voices of enslaved people that we weren't able to hear. And we tried to do it in a really metaphorical, historical imagination way. But the position is because Benjamin Franklin's statue is on the heart of Penn's campus. So to put it under the foundation of Benjamin Franklin, like everything was founded on slavery by slave owners because of slavery. So then I'm gonna take you guys to the Penn Museum. The Penn Museum, one of the things that has been really a big topic of conversation in the Penn Museum is the Samuel Morton collection. Samuel Morton was a scientist who studied and I think taught at Penn, and he collected a lot of skulls. He was part of the group of phrenologists that also, you know, organized those skulls into a number of different races and did the racial hierarchy. Now, the thing about Penn is these skulls were inside of the museum, and they were stashed in the closets, the glass cabinets of an anthropology classroom. So students who look like me were sitting next to the evidence to prove that they didn't belong and that in that campus. So what we did was you take your phone and you go outside the Penn Museum, and a dome spawns with all of the different artifacts and information that these scientists, not only Morton, but Charles Caldwell and all of these men used to do this research. And you can kind of see how not only, you know, it's all around you, but all of these things are interconnected. You know, this educational and academic genealogy created this body of knowledge that affects us to this day, and it's everywhere. Also, we decided to move it from the inside of the museum. It was private history, and we publicized it. You know, this app is free. You can do it from right here. You don't even need to be on Penn's campus. We've taken that information that was private, and we've made it public in a way that I think is really important. And this is my favorite stop. So my friend and cohort mate, Brianna Moore, she is a wonderful scholar, amazing person, great dancer. And she came to the Penn and Slavery Project when I was an undergraduate. She had conducted her own research on her own family to find, to discover that her ancestors were owned by fellow Penn alum ancestors. Does that make sense? Does that scan? Okay, cool. It makes more sense if you download the app and watch the documentary that she produced, because she's amazing. So she tracked this down, and she did all this genealogical research and put together a documentary, and then she lent us her research for the project. What happened? Okay, so what this stop is what this bridge you see here, this is the Generations Bridge, and this bridge has all these bricks that are stamped with the names of fancy donors and alums and people who paid a lot of money to go here and to get their name all over campus. And Bree's family isn't on that bridge, but the fact that her family was owned by another Penn family is proof of that generational wealth that people of color were not allowed to accrue. Now, this is her family's quilt. She let us 3D model it, and then we've put different clips of the documentary in the different squares of the quilt, so you can select them and watch different parts of it. She's an amazing scholar, and I'm so glad that she lent us her research, because this is what we wanted this project to do. We wanted it to be a digital interruption of the campus. Okay, we can't change the name of buildings. Okay, we can't, you know, burn it all to the ground. The campus is made of stone. It's very difficult to burn it. But what we could do is take some of the things that you see on campus, and we could peel it back and reveal the history that has been hidden, that has been obscured. And there are three other stops that do this in other cool ways. So let me know if you want to download the app, and I will let you know, or I'll give you the information. But from the outset, we wanted to challenge our university to take accountability for its history. And we hoped it would be a stepping stone to reparative actions and reparative justice. We wanted Penn to acknowledge and address its historical and modern day relationship with the greater Philadelphia community and some of the harms that it has done. And most important, and the most important part of that, and I feel that there are some grad students here who understand that, is to keep making noise, to keep digging and to keep researching and to keep giving presentations and facilitating conversations and demanding to be heard. And we did that, and eventually the university did acknowledge that they had connections to slavery. Hold your applause. Because then they relocated the skull collection. And this is a lovely picture of me out here carrying a sign in the middle of a pandemic. My mother was very proud. We demanded that they repatriate the museum, the skull collection, and they have now done that. And I am trying to wiggle my way onto the committee that's deciding what to do with that. But there are a lot of credentials that you need to have to do that, and I do not have those. The thing I'm most proud about, which you can applaud after this, is thinking about the university's own academic history, thinking about its own history. So this is George Whitefield. This is a statue. You remember the red dot I showed you a while ago? This is the red dot. This is George Whitefield. George Whitefield was one of the godfathers of evangelical thought. And if there are any religious historians, like, they can give you the rundown on that. But long story short, he was one of the first preachers to preach to integrated audiences. And he did not like slave owners who didn't convert their slaves to Christianity. And he thought it was really messed up. So lived in Philadelphia, he built a church, and then all of a sudden he decided to move to South Carolina, and one of his friends gave him a plantation. And then he realized, oh, slavery is really profitable, I see. So he wanted to open an orphanage in Georgia with that same model. But Georgia, the colony at that time, had outlawed slavery because they were afraid that slaves were going to rise up and, you know, overthrow the slave owners because of all the things that are going on in the Caribbean and all these different things, history. But long story short, George Whitefield said, if you don't allow me to have slaves on my property, I will not hold my business in your colony. And so this guy, George Whitefield, re-legalized slavery in the colony of Georgia. Now, what does that have to do with Penn, VanJessica? Very little. So the building he built when he was in Philadelphia, 15 years later, that became the place where Penn held its first class. So technically, our start date would have been 1755. But Princeton's start date is 1748, and we couldn't have that. So we made George Whitefield part of our legacy so that we could say we started in 1740 so that we could be earlier than Princeton, which means that we... which means that we have included a man who re-legalized the institution of slavery in a colony and died with 50, having bequeathed 50 enslaved people to another person, a statue on our campus, so we could say that we're better than another school. So my argument is that we're talking about tackling inequality, and I love that. And Professor Ayers came up and said a lot of things about diversifying campuses and making sure that student bodies look like the world around us. But it's also important to investigate the universities we are trying to diversify. So when students who look like me overcome all those obstacles and enter the academic spaces, we don't have to walk by statues of guys like these reminding us that we shouldn't even be here. The longstanding falsehood that we don't deserve to be here, that any spot that we earned here was not because of our own effort. And the key to projects like this is for universities and administrators to listen to those concerns. So when we said that I wanted Whitefield to move out, I got the statue taken down. My research got the statue taken down. Thank you. And so I think that when we move men and statues and names and ideologies like Whitefield and Samuel Morton and Ebenezer Kennersley and all of these out of the way, we also need to open avenues to academic spaces for underrepresented schools or for underrepresented communities. So Penn, I don't know if Stony Brook has this problem, but Penn is a nonprofit and doesn't really pay property taxes in the city, which is like a big problem because public schools are funded with property taxes. So, you know. That's bad. Yes, thank you. It's bad. There's a whole organization, Penn Pilots. They know a lot more information about it than I do. But the long and short of it is, when we start doing this and start listening to students on campus who have issues with their campus and the way that it's happening or the way people are being treated on campus, that bleeds out to the way that universities interact with the remainder of the community. So I guess what I'm saying is, when you start thinking about tackling inequality in university spaces, there are people who are going to do it. There are spaces to do it. And as Professor Ayers so wonderfully said, you can do that from different schools and different fields. So I was able to use this app not only to get a statue taken down, but to convince my parents that it was okay for me to drop out of engineering school. Thank you.
Is a statewide education policy and advocacy organization. Our work centers equity for New York State students, ranging from early childhood education all the way through higher education and the workforce. Our work is data and research driven, and we work closely with various statewide education coalitions. And our goal is to inform key policy decisions that affect the educational and lived experiences of New York State students.
And I know when we were speaking ahead of time, you said that one of the main priorities that you've been working on is something called an attainment goal and helping New York State to begin to think about creating an attainment goal. Can you tell us about what that is and why it's important?
Yeah, of course. So for those of you who don't know what an attainment goal is, it's a target usually set by the state or education governing body for its residents to reach a certain level of degree attainment by a set date. For each state, the aspirational level of attainment varies. Some states have an associate's degree as a goal, a bachelor's degree, or some form of high quality credential or degree as a benchmark. Some states have set a target for all three. The age range for the population of working age adults ranges as well. There are states who have set goals for their residents from ages 25 to 34 or 25 to 64. And the time horizon for the goal to be completed also ranges from 5 to 15 years. I believe most states right now have a goal by 2025 or 2030. Mm-hmm. Here at EdTrust, we believe raising the level of attainment for the state is important because it forces the state to address disparities in post-secondary opportunity, which is especially important for historically underserved students. For example, I believe someone spoke to this a little earlier, but white students are actually twice as likely to earn a bachelor's degree than their Black and Latinx counterparts nationwide. Degree attainment for families from higher income or students from higher income families are also much higher than for students who come from lower income backgrounds. Therefore, it's also important for states to set specific targets for historically underserved groups, especially first generation college students. And raising attainment is important because degree attainment isn't inextricably linked to economic opportunity and financial security. More jobs are requiring a post-secondary education, which not only provides greater job security, but also tends to lead to higher wages. I believe the current national college wage premium is estimated to be about $30,000 a year. And an attainment goal is important for New York State to ensure its workforce is prepared to meet the demands of a competitive job market and keep pace with our growing economy. As part of the Raising Equity and Attainment in College Hire or Reach New York Coalition, the Education Trust New York urges the state to adopt an equity-driven attainment goal of 60% for New Yorkers of all races and ethnicities by 2030. As of 2018, New York State residents between the ages of 25 and 64 with an associate's degree or higher was 49%. So this goal would mean that we'd need to increase post-secondary attainment by approximately 1.3 million residents by 2030. There are two paths toward that attainment goal. The first is to increase enrollment at two-year and four-year institutions in New York State, and the second is to increase completion.
Thank you. And Dawn, I see you nodding. You want to talk a little bit about how that kind of strategy informs your work here at SUNY?
So I would say it's informed my work that brought me to Stony Brook. So at my previous institution in the state of Michigan, we were very focused on a 60 by 30, so 60% degree attainment. And one of the focuses that we have, and as everyone is aware, there is a declining high school graduation rate, and so that then leads to a declining high school population to come to college. And that's based on birth rate. And so adult student re-engagement is one of those options and one of those ways that we can support. And so when you were speaking about the students who start college but fail to complete, in that situation and in that time frame, we have done harm to those students because they have borrowed money, they have incurred debt, and they have left worse off. And so I believe as higher education institutions, we need to find ways to bring those people back to the path and help them complete. And it isn't just about a baccalaureate degree, it's a post-secondary credential, which is very often the entryway for the economic development opportunities that you were speaking to earlier. And so I think that is a focus that higher education institutions need to take on, and we need to find ways to support students in equitable ways and make sure that they are able to attain that and be very clear about being student-ready institutions as opposed to expecting students to be college-ready. And I think that's a huge focus and a huge shift for us.
Thank you. Casey, can you talk a little bit about sort of, you know, what are the things that you're doing day to day that you're helping to try and move this goal forward? And then we'll talk a little bit more about some of the obstacles that students are encountering. But as a data analyst, you have such an interesting skill set bring to this problem.
Yeah, I kind of heard you said, so I'm going to try and answer what I did here. As an organization, a lot of our higher education analyses touch upon issues that would impact the state's ability to increase attainment. So we released a report on Beyond Attainment looking at median income for fields of study at certain institutions, knowing that a degree can only get a student so far if it doesn't lead to workforce preparedness. Some of the issues that we address as well include access and affordability, improving completion, pathways to careers, and accountability and transparency. So after we do an analysis, release a report, a lot of our advocacy conversations revolve around those four pillars. We believe are essential in order to reach any attainment goal.
One of the things that I think is most interesting when we're talking about this research is we're looking at students who have to find a path to college and then have to find a way through. Mm-hmm. And so we historically at institutions, it has been, and in the college admission world and financial aid, it's been about a student just getting in the front door. And we haven't necessarily focused at the same time of all the support systems that a student may need in order to be successful. And so I think a lot of the work is going to come in this attainment, again, is meeting students. You know, what kind of childcare options do we have? What kind of opportunities for different learning things? And I love the fact that when you were talking about this and all the different ways to support students and valuing the work that occurs outside of the classroom in support of the classroom. And I think that's a very important thing we need to look at as institutions, how we are supporting the entire enterprise that we expect to support the entire student. And we are doing more in that realm all the time. I mean, there are food pantries and clothing options and hot meals and emergency housing, because those are the students that are coming to us that we need to support as educational, you know, enterprises.
My mother actually was the director of continuing education at a liberal arts college, and one of the cool projects they did was actually an initiative to help young single mothers, it was a women's college, to pursue a college education. And when they got in, they had childcare and housing available and provided to them. And it certainly made the campus more fun to have all these kids running around while their moms were going to class. So I want to ask a little bit more generally from our panelists to think about, from your perspectives, and we have a diverse range of perspectives here, what do you see as some of the most significant barriers to student success at the moment?
I'll take this one.
I think you can probably each speak to it from a different perspective.
So I think there are a lot of barriers to student success, and I think the first and foremost is first generation students, they don't know how to college. And so learning the business of, and just being 18 years old, think of a traditional age freshman going to college for the first time. Perhaps you've never made your own dental appointment. You've never made your own doctor's appointment. You don't necessarily know how to tend to your car or fix certain things. So helping students learn how to do the business of going to college, you know, what is a master promissory note when it comes to financial aid? What are you doing there? And so I think the best thing that we can do as institutions to help student success is to knock down those barriers before students ever get there. And to me, that's truly the mission of the support services around a student, is to make sure that the financial aid goes smoothly, because it's too easy for a student to find a barrier and not have the support to get over that barrier. So we as institutions need to make sure that tutoring is available and it's readily accessible and we can support it. We need to make sure that academic support, that we understand first generation students don't know the importance of office hours for faculty. You know, I was too scared. I was a first generation Pell student. My dad completed eighth grade. My mom graduated from high school. And I didn't know the importance of going to office hours. I didn't know that in order to become a college faculty member, that I could graduate with my bachelor's degree and someone would pay me to do research and go on and get a doctoral degree. I was trying to figure out a way that I could hustle, work a job, get a master's, get a job that would pay, do those things in order to get an advanced degree. And so those are the things that, at institutions, that I think we can build into our systems and our processes to really support students to know that they are wanted and that they can be supported.
Yeah, a lot of that, what you're talking about, reminds me of when I was doing grad school orientation and we talked about unpacking the hidden curriculum. Mm-hmm. And, like, that's what that
exactly.
was. I was an undergrad at the same school I attended grad school, or I now attend grad school, and the concept of office hours has shifted so much, because when you get to college, everyone's like, you go to office hours if you have no idea what's going on in the class. It's like, I have some idea of what's going on in this class, so I shouldn't go to office hours. Mm-hmm. But yeah, if we start, I don't know, I love this idea of thinking about not only getting to, but getting through. But I think a school can have all of these resources, but we also need to stop, break down the acronyms, and,
yes.
and it's they're in secret buildings sometimes. Like, sometimes I did not know my school had the things to help me
yes.
that they have, and I just did not know that they were there until someone asked me, why did you not do that thing?
Yes.
And it's very hard to look at a professor and say, because I did not know
yes.
that I could do it. So,
yeah,
that's a barrier.
As I was suggesting, if we wait until people are getting ready to apply for college, it's too late.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And the rhetoric of failure that has surrounded higher education by people with whom I disagree is actually impedes people to believe that they can succeed. And so you've got, on one hand, foot on accelerator, you have to do this, you have to do this, but we're not going to tell you how. On the other hand, if you do this, you're just going to go deep into debt, and it doesn't matter anyway. It's been interesting to see the declining number of young men who are going to college.
Mm-hmm.
And where does this belief come from that I don't need college to do what? So somehow, even though we're in the knowledge industry, we're not able to control the public message of what we're doing. So I think that a colleague of mine looked at this problem and said, I have these great students. I don't really believe in Teach for America because they don't know how to teach. What they do know how to do is get into college. Mm-hmm. And create the college advising corps, mm-hmm. where these kids go, recent graduates, 2 years, go and are in a high school and get to know the kids and say, here's what a FAFSA form is. And yeah, mm-hmm. you can major in that, or no, you don't have to major in that, and so forth. Or but you do need to take as many advanced placement classes as you can, or you know, whatever. Mm-hmm. Stuff that they, you know, because the average guidance counselor has 500 kids reporting mm-hmm. to her or him. So mm-hmm. I think that we're going to have to, that's the reason I was talking about breaking down all these barriers. Mm-hmm. We've made it now as if we're selling a product and rather than engaged in a collaborative enterprise. You know, so there's a lot that's wrong.
I want to add just a little bit to that because I think we in higher education have done that to ourselves.
Yep.
And the provost will laugh because I always have to have an analogy or a story when I tell something. But in higher education, I like to fish, and so I fish a lot, and when I approach a stream or a pond, if I look and there are a lot of dead fish in that pond or stream, I do not stand on the bank and yell at the fish as to why they didn't swim well, or they didn't find good food, or they should have known to do these kinds of things, because that would be insanity. But in higher education, we invite everybody to come, and we have the whole cycle, and in admissions, and people, you know, we show we're 10 to 15, where a student gets into 10 or 15 colleges, as if that is the success point. Mm. And then what happens when a student comes and they can't navigate our stream or our pond, and, you know, they fail, we put the target on them, and we stand there and we go, what was wrong with that fish that it couldn't swim in our pond? As opposed to every other time we look and say, what is wrong with our water? And so when students are not successful, I think that we as institutions really need to make sure that we're looking about the secret curriculum and the secret opportunities and how we're supporting students. And we cannot put the target on them. We need to look at that from our standpoint in the system that we have created. So I think in some ways we are to blame for people devaluing what we are offering because we have made it a mysterious commodity.
And I agree, and acting as if, and it's, I look forward to my friend learning more about all of this, of outselling, this is the only place that mm-hmm. you can have a satisfying educational experience. I was giving that talk one time to a bunch of parents. I said, I just want to stop and tell you, this is an awesome place, but there's other places you can go that you'll be happy to. Because it acts as if it's this commodity that's of limited production, and we have this much of it, and other places, and it's nonsense. Mm-hmm. And so I think that's another way we've done it to ourselves, and it's all about competition. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I've been known to brag our admittance rate. I've been known to
yep.
brag about all the students' dreams we crush.
I also... Casey, do you want to add, from your perspective, I've known you've done focus groups with students. Do you have a sense of what kinds of barriers you think are particularly concerning?
You're muted.
You're muted.
Famous line.
Famous line.
Sorry. Yes. I agree with a lot of things everyone else has said. I think those goes back to affordability and access, both things which have only been further exacerbated by the pandemic. I believe the pandemic has highlighted the need to address those things even more, as well as the wraparound services that students need to succeed. The New York State student body is more diverse than ever, and therefore institutions should be prepared to meet those diverse needs. We have students who are from low-income backgrounds, student parents, students experiencing homelessness, foster youth, first-generation college students, students of color, veterans, undocumented students with mixed family statuses, students from immigrant communities, students with alternative high school pathways, adult learners, and the list really just goes on. I'm not sure if I want to get or should get into like pandemic related concerns, but get into that a little later. But yeah.
Okay. Do you want to add something? I want to leave a little time for questions from the audience. So you want to have one last thought, Jessica?
Just saying that I like the way you said it was a pond and not a stream, because I think another one of the barriers is, and this is something I faced, we just treat college like a stepping stone into a job. Mm-hmm. And so, I don't know, it's supposed to be an experience. Like, it's okay to major in philosophy because philosophy's interesting. I don't know. But that's a whole problem with, like, employment, and then you just capitalism. And next question.
All right, I want to leave time for some audience questions. Anyone in the house would like to ask a question of our esteemed panelists? Is that Greg in the back?
Oh, yeah, please.
Yeah, please, Greg.
First of all, I wanted to thank all of you for this fascinating symposium. I was really interested in all of your presentations. I have a question for Professor Ayers. I was hoping you could speak a little bit more about access to inequality of universities. You were saying in your talk that you've made great progress in making the university more diverse and reflected you criticism of rising tuition by citing the cost of supporting a more diverse student body. But that seems somewhat contrary to the findings of recent higher ed historiography. I'm thinking of scholars like Jeremy Baldwin or Sarah Ahmed. Interest from capital projects, that's a much bigger driver of cost than DEI initiatives. So why does DEI raise tuition? Do you worry that could risk essentially asking a diverse student body to shoulder the burden for diversity on campus, the financial burden?
What a great question, and I can see why that's what you interpreted me saying, and it's a. I was pointing out that's the two parallel truths I was talking about, right? One, these things have happened, right? Two, these costs have gone up. My own sense is that capital projects are not what drives the cost. What drives the cost is the addition of new layers of what you would call administrators, right? So it's not all about DEI. A lot of it is about things that are pandering to prosperous students, okay? But the point that I was making ineptly, I can hear now, is that a lot of that is necessary. And it's not just students of minority background who are eating disorders and all kinds of psychological challenges that are coming in, right? And what I'm saying is it's okay that we're taking care of people. It's a pond, it's an experience, it's the most stressful time. So next time, if I ever say these words again, I'll avoid that confusion, because I think that's a legitimate concern. We don't want to blame the diversity for driving up the cost for everybody. That's not what I intended to say, but in some ways it's what I said. So thanks for, I appreciate that.
Other questions?
Correlation is not equal.
Yeah. Not causation.
But. Yes, please.
I would like to answer just a few things that I think that you all can do. There was recently a change, I believe Amherst made, where so a lot of private institutions have what's known as legacy admissions. And so slots for students are set aside because their parents went there. There are also slots in admissions that are set aside for large donors who have given big donations, you know, maybe named buildings and their child comes. The use of standardized test scores historically have kept students out as opposed to welcoming them in. The awarding of scholarships to students solely based on merit and not a combination of merit and need. The funding of elementary schools and high schools based on property tax revenues as opposed to a flat rate. Public policy on educational opportunities for all students. Those are the things, really off the top of my head, I can tell you, are things that are shaping this discussion. And so by coming to symposiums like this, having your voice heard, you've already made those first steps. But educational policy sometimes isn't as cool or, you know, as phenomenally sexy as history, you know.
But what is, actually?
Not everyone can be this sexy.
One of those things too. So, you know, you all, but educational policy wonks are needed to help set and shape how we're going to move forward in elementary, secondary, and higher education, and then beyond. And so I would encourage you to keep looking and asking and participating in things just like this, and take it a step further. Your vote matters, your support matters. When you're looking at folks, a lot of the rhetoric has been that higher education doesn't matter. You all know that's not true. So get involved in those discussions as well.
What?
I would just have one very brief comment, and flip that around. Teach in elementary and middle schools.
Yes.
Yeah.
You know, if you...
Casey, can you say a word about how you came to the work that
yes.
you're doing? Because how did you come to do the work you're doing, Casey? If our students want to follow in your path, how did you get into this work? We have a lot of student activists in the hall.
I'm considered a recent grad, so hopefully can shed a little light onto this. I spent a great deal of time within student affairs and higher education as an undergrad, and decided that I wanted to pursue education policy in New York because it's been a passion of mine. I've worked with in college readiness and college access programs. Since I was still in college, and it's something that I wanted to continue to do, but at the policy and advocacy level, the transition to programming and policy has been really challenging because I'm not used to not working with students as much. The conversations that we have with elected officials is very different. Because we have to convince them that our issues are important, our news issues are important, and that students, these are the things that students really care about. I've been with EdTrust for about 2 years now. I only graduated about 3 years ago, so it hasn't been that long.
Well, impressive. VanJessica, you want to say a word about student activism around this issue?
There are groups, student groups are like everywhere. There are student groups on my campus. There's different centers that try to get things and people involved in the community. But sometimes I get really worried that we're doing like the plastic straw, the straw thing, mm-hmm. where we're asking like individuals to solve a problem that's an institutional problem. Not that individuals shouldn't get out and help in their community, but also like, yes, go to, you know, school board meetings, vote, yell at politicians, speak to them calmly. I think that it's an institutional problem, and I do think that there are groups and activists, and I really want to have conversation with you, Casey, about how to like get involved with things that you're up to, because you're doing some cool stuff. Again, so basically I have no answer, but I will ask a lot of questions to people after this panel.
I think we have time for one last question. Yes?
Yes, thank you everyone for a great discussion, and I want to direct my question to all the panelists. And so far we talked about mostly undergraduate education, and also Professor Ayers, you mentioned how finances administration one of the important arteries of the university. But I want to point your attention to another, what I think is a fundamental artery, and that's graduate labor. And the labor of graduate students, the instruction of graduate students, and in Stony Brook, graduate students are responsible, we are responsible for 60% of And as opposed to this, we're a minuscule part of the total salaries and compensation for all the workers. And we estimate that to be under 10%. So I'm just curious about all the panelists think of this area of inequality and many other inequalities that graduate workers face.
Can I speak to graduate funding?
Yes, I will. So what I will say about that is I have, as you know, I've been here since mid-July. And in the conversations at the provost level and then at the executive leadership team, you are being heard. Those discussions are happening. I was privy and privileged to hear the other day regarding the meeting that you all had had with some of our leadership to talk about this issue. And I think that what you all have brought forward is very much like the research that has been done. This is an area where we need to have these discussions, we need to be working on it. And there is need in a variety of areas and a variety of different financial models for the institution. And as one of my colleagues often says, it's how we're going to slice the pie. And so the pie doesn't get bigger, but we have to decide, you know, how we're going to slice and support that. And I think that this is a historical time in graduate school education, graduate funding. We're looking at it from an undergraduate level, also for you all. And I don't think the problem is solved yet. But what I am excited about, and what, you know, VanJessica and I talk about, is the fact that this is exactly where these conversations need to be happening, is in a higher education world where we can address them, we can run at them, and we can really work to solve them. And I think that's the evolution that we've seen over the course of the last few months with this discussion on this institution, is that you have administrators who want to run toward this, and they want to figure out a solution in partnership with you all.
And the other thing I would add is, having just finished a term as three-year term as graduate director in history, is that every incremental change that we've had, they have gone in a positive direction, and all of them have been pushed forward by the coordinated efforts of the faculty and the graduate students and the administrators working together and in dialogue and trying to figure out, because, you know, we are the ones who are going to be saying what our priorities are, mm-hmm. right? And our priorities is that all, to use your analogy, is that all the fish in the brook need to thrive and need to have what they need to succeed. And some of my teaching assistants are in the house today, and I know how wonderful they are, how hardworking they are, and how much I learn from them and they're learning from me. You know, when I was a graduate student at NYU, we had to fight for the right to have a union. We weren't considered employees, and we went on strike to make the point that the exams weren't going to get graded if we were on strike. And I ended my graduate career affiliated with the United Auto Workers, which you guys have cool t-shirts, but the UAW had really cool t-shirts. So I just want to encourage everyone, as some of you visitors may have gathered, we are working on trying to improve our graduate students' funding, and it's a really important issue. And I want everybody to continue the conversation around this and have patience and forbearance, because we're hopefully moving in the right direction. And I know this is an important concern of the president, and we will keep swimming upstream. No, not upstream. We're going to swim. Bad analogy. So thank you, everybody. Can you join me in thanking our panelists? And Casey, thank you so much. Thank you.